in the race for Congress, there's a lot on the line, especially in California's 3rd District. From the shores of Lake Tahoe to Placer and Sacramento suburbs, the Plumas National Forest, all the way to Death Valley. Tonight, the candidates answer questions that impact you. Inflation, Roe v. Wade, and more. Meet the Democrat, Dr. Kermit Jones, and the Republican, State Assembly Member Kevin Kiley. This is the KCRA 3 CapRadio Debate for Congress, District 3. Now, moderators Edie Lambert and Nicole Nixon.
Welcome to the debate between candidates in California's 3rd Congressional District.
We want to quickly walk you through the ground rules that each of the candidates have agreed to. For each of the questions, they have a one-minute answer. If there is a rebuttal or a follow-up question, they have 30 seconds to respond. For some of the questions, we're just looking for a quick yes or no answer. We want to thank all of our viewers and our listeners for sending in some really great questions. We've incorporated as many as possible, and we love to see all the interest in this debate.
We want to start with a chance for each of you to clearly define your positions on issues that have been focal points this campaign season, and that each of you has you saying that your own position has been distorted. So starting with the gas tax, which is a big issue here in California as drivers pay the highest average gas prices in the country. Dr. Jones, your opponent says that you want to raise the gas tax. Do you?
Nicole, that's absolutely wrong. I mean, I know that my opponent has become the Don Quixote of the gas tax of California, but the reality is we need people that actually want to solve this problem and not use it as just a political stepping stone to run for, I think, maybe the 4th or 5th office that he's run for at this point. What I want to do is actually increase our ability to produce gas at home, increase our refining capabilities. That's something he could have worked on the assembly. We know that there's 6 refineries that are down in California, and diversify our energy sources. I think those are things that we need to focus on. I've never been for the gas tax. I even said it in our last debate, but I think when you have a bunch of DC consultants telling you what to say, then you don't really care whether it's a truth or not, as long as you can get it on the air. So I've absolutely not been for raising the gas tax or any taxes on gas whatsoever.
Just a quick follow-up. You say you want to increase the state's ability to produce at home, so you are for more oil drilling in the state of California.
That's actually not what I said. I said that there's 6 refineries that are down. As you probably know, the output of a refinery is greater than the input of a refinery. So I think if we fix that issue, as well as diversify our energy sources, then we will get a better position to actually have energy independence and not have to go to other countries and beg them to turn on the spigot.
Assemblymember Kiley, we want to give you a chance to clearly define your position on the federal gas tax.
Well, of course I'm against it. And, you know, you just heard my opponent himself say he's criticizing me for trying to suspend the gas tax here in California that would save every driver 54 cents a gallon. And you just also heard him say that he doesn't want to increase our capacity to make America energy independent, which would lower gas prices across the board. But I want to thank everyone for tuning in tonight. And it would be a great honor to represent you as the new member of Congress for our district, a district where I was born and raised, where I went to local public schools, and that has always been my home. I'm planning on getting to work right away as your congressman to move our country in a new direction. And elections are about choices, and in this race we have a very clear choice. My opponent has spent much of his career in Washington, D.C. as a political staffer and as a lawyer. And he started this campaign by saying his goal was to keep his party in power, keep Pelosi as speaker, so they could make even more changes, in his words. I don't think we need to go further down the path that we're on right now. I think we need a new direction as a country. We need more balance. We need more common sense. We need a check against the overreaching policies in Washington, D.C.
Quickly on the gas tax follow-up, how do you ensure that suspending the federal or state gas tax would actually result in lowered gas prices?
Well, we've seen it happen. Other states have suspended their gas taxes. Even very blue states like New York and Connecticut have suspended their gas taxes, and those prices were passed on to consumers. The same thing would happen here. And so despite my opponent's criticism, I'm going to continue to advocate for folks to get at least 54 cents off of each gallon of gas by suspending the gas tax here, as well as suspending it at the federal level.
Thanks.
And as Nicole said, we wanted to start out this debate with giving you both a chance to set the record straight on some of the allegations that have been made during the campaign. So, Assemblymember Kiley, you have been portrayed in campaign ads as supporting a near total ban on abortions. Is that in fact your position? And also, would you vote for Senator Lindsey Graham's proposal for a federal ban on most abortions after 15 weeks of gestation?
The answer to both of those is no. I think it's a state issue, and I'm running for a United States office. The Sacramento Bee did a fact check on my opponent's ads. They found that he was lying, and yet he continued to do the ads. And he's basically run a single-issue campaign around this one issue. By the way, his own view on the issue is one that about 95% of the public does not support. He favors full elective abortion right up until the moment of birth. And so why is he fixating on this one issue, though? He has no plans for dealing with inflation, getting gas and grocery prices under control. He has no plans for securing the border. He has no plans for getting crime under control. And the reason he doesn't is because he supported all of the policies that led to these problems. He supported the $4 trillion spending spree that Nancy Pelosi rammed through Congress. He supported it every step of the way, and he began his campaign by saying his goal is to keep his party in power, keep Pelosi as speaker, so we can have even more of that. I don't think we need to keep going down the direction we're going right now. I think we need a new direction as a country. We need change, and we need balance in our government.
So the question was designed, let me just first of all get you on the record for exactly where you stand in terms of your opposition to abortions. You said you don't support a near total ban. So for voters in your district, where exactly do you draw that line?
There's nothing I do as a member of Congress that would in any way affect what's allowed in California. This is a state issue, and so the level of access that exists right now will not be affected by anything I do as a member of Congress.
You don't want to state exactly where you might have exemptions, exceptions?
Well, it's a state issue, so I wouldn't be voting to restrict anything as a member of Congress.
All right, Dr. Jones.
I mean, one of the things that I think my opponent and I do agree with is that Congress is broken, Washington's broken, and politicians like him are broken. I think the reality is there were so many lies that were just thrown out in the last 2 minutes, it's kind of hard to actually respond to them, but I'll try to do the best I can. One, never said anything that he said with respect to keeping the Democrats in power. I think in reality, both sides are broken. We have one side that focuses on things like defunding the police, and then we have the other side, like my opponent, that focuses on trying to lie their way through an election. He did have an opportunity to vote on strengthening the right to abortion in California and making a constitutional amendment, voted against it. He had an opportunity to make it so that women would not be criminalized for miscarriages. He voted against it. What he could do, other than trying to run on a single issue with respect to the gas tax, having actually gotten nothing done, that's the criticism. The criticism is he runs on issues, runs for office, costs us $240 million, which, by the way, would have bought about 60 million gallons of gas, which would have been about enough to pay for about the gas for about a quarter of the people in our district. Instead of focusing on the things that keeps him running for office, he focuses on those things that divide people. Something new.
Voters consistently say they are extremely concerned about inflation and the rising cost of everything from milk to cars. So given that inflation is currently a very complex global issue, does Congress have a role to play in reining in these rising prices? Dr. Jones, this question will go to you first.
I 100% think that Congress can do the right thing on this issue and has a lot of power with it. As you said, this is a global issue. It's an issue that came after the pandemic. It's one that does need us to bring our supply chains back home, makes us make sure that we need to bring jobs back to our district and lower the costs here in our district. One of the things that I focus on is a federal fire insurance plan, because I know that there are people in our district that are paying way too much. They used to pay $1,000 a year. Now they're paying over $10,000 a year. I want to lower that cost for them and help them with that cost. The cost of health care is way too much. That's why I think being able to negotiate down drug prices is a big deal. My opponent feels differently. He feels that taking money from pharmaceutical companies and voting their interests and making it so that children can have access to lower cost insulin is the way to go. I think we need something different. I think that approach is the cancer, and we actually need the cure. And the cure is to not have continuous politicians running for office, not focusing on our issues, but focusing on themselves.
Assemblymember Kiley, does Congress have a role to play in inflation and controlling costs?
Yes, and the first thing to do is to stop the out-of-control spending. You know, folks in our district and across the country are struggling mightily under the weight of absolutely record inflation, record gas prices, record grocery prices. And even Barack Obama's top economic advisor said at the time, don't spend all that money. Don't go on a $4 trillion spending spree. This was Barack Obama's top economic advisor. Now, my opponent worked in the Obama-Biden administration. He spent a good deal of his career as a lawyer, as a political staffer, in Washington, D.C., and he supported and celebrated that $4 trillion, please let me finish my answer, that $4 trillion in spending that even Barack Obama's top economic advisor warned against. And he did say, as the very first thing when he launched his campaign, that he needed to keep his party in power in the House, which would mean keep Pelosi as Speaker, so they can make, this is an exact quote, even more changes. So what you can count on, if he's elected, is even more out-of-control spending. I'm going to rein in spending, I'm going to roll back regulations, and I'm going to pursue American energy independence so that we can set our own gas prices here and not be dependent on foreign.
I have a follow-up for you, and then I'll give you a chance to rebut.
Yeah.
What specifically would you cut? If you're talking
Have you taken a look at the federal budget? There is so much waste, fraud, and abuse. It is absolutely unbelievable. And let's just look at this $4 trillion spending plan that my opponent supported each and every step of the way. I mean, you had money that went to golf courses. You had money that went to luxury hotels. You had these stimulus payments that went to prisoners. The Boston Marathon bomber got one of these stimulus payments. Or if you can look across every single agency. Or, for example, the 87,000 IRS agents that this new bill is going to hire because of the new bill that was just signed into law. My opponent supported that. One of the first votes that I would take in Congress is to repeal those 87,000 IRS agents.
Thank you. Dr. Jones, your response.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think my opponent would be as effective in Congress as he was effective in the Assembly. He's run on constant things and pretty much either gotten nothing done or voted the interests of the people that have paid him money. First and foremost, I am a physician, internal medicine doctor, Navy veteran. I was endorsed by the largest police officers organization in the country, PORAC, which demonstrates that the ads that have been run against me are complete lies, just like pretty much every single word that's come out of my opponent's mouth. I was not a staffer in the Obama administration. I was a White House fellow. And the bigger picture here is that I have an opponent that wants to focus more on distractions than actual policies. You had mentioned yourself and asked him multiple times what he would actually do. He has no plan. He has no platform, and that's all he has are lies.
Can I have a rebuttal to that? I just got to say, I mean, this is a candidate who doesn't even live in our district, and who has now run for Congress in multiple districts that he doesn't actually live in. And he started his campaign by saying that the only way he was ever going to be able to get anything done and make the changes that he wants is if his party stayed in power. Have a record of getting legislation passed
right there,
as a member of the minority.
That was not a rebuttal. That was another accusation. Do you live in the district?
I moved into this area 5 years ago. I've been here for the last 5 years. And I think the bigger picture here that my opponent wants to distract people from is that the whole time I was taking care of people with respect to their health care, he was standing with insurrectionists and neo-Nazis. And I think at the end of the day, what we need to focus on are people that have done things in this district, care about this district. I've never seen someone from a place do so little for it. He's voted against multiple things that actually could help people. Keep our kids safe with respect to red flag laws.
Slung like that at you. Do you support neo-Nazis?
This is just crazy stuff. He's begged and pleaded the Sacramento Bee to print these wild allegations, and they've refused to do it because they looked into it as total nonsense. He said this so many times that I finally looked up, what is he even talking about? So what he's referring to is this. You almost can't make it up. So out of the hundreds and hundreds of events I've been to, he claims that there's like one guy who's won this event. I didn't know him, didn't know he'd be there, didn't know who it was, who said some crazy thing sometime. So I finally look into who this guy is. Turns out he was a candidate for the U.S. Senate. I had endorsed his opponent, who ended up winning the Republican nomination. So this is the big attack that Kermit is hanging his hat on.
I've never seen someone actually take pictures with someone.
Excuse me,
they don't
please don't interrupt me. Is trying to attack me, trying to associate me with someone that I actively worked to defeat. And the reason he focuses on this nonsense is because he's supported all of the policies that have wrecked our economy.
Okay, we gave you a chance to answer.
Multiple news outlets have demonstrated that you actually do associate with these people.
Move
you're trying
this
to not
on.
Associate with.
We asked and answered.
You can't make it up.
Okay, so voters are also obviously very concerned about the economy. One of the places includes the housing market. Interest rates have more than doubled in the last year. Just this week, they hit 7%. That's the highest in 20 years. So what could you do as members of Congress to help Americans and Californians reach their dream of owning a home? And Assemblymember Kiley, we'll start with you.
Well, we need to get our economy back on track. I mean, that's one of the biggest drivers of inflation is home prices. And home prices in California have been absolutely out of control. We make it so difficult to build in this state. We make it so difficult to even get a project off the ground. You had to have tens of thousands of dollars in fees. You can have years or decades that a project is waiting to make its way through the bureaucracy and to get approval. And you're right, this is the foundation of the American dream, and it's out of reach for far too many people. And it's why a lot of folks, by the way, are leaving our state. But the broader picture is that we have an economy that has been absolutely on the wrong track. And the first priority as a member of Congress is I want to get it back on track to make everything in our economy more affordable. So that means reining in spending. It means rolling back all of these regulations on businesses that have increased the cost of living for everyone. It means reactivating our workforce, so we're giving folks an incentive to work again. It means making our country energy independent, so we're not reliant on foreign sources of energy. And it means fixing our supply chain, which has been disrupted by a number of very bad policies put in place by this administration.
Dr. Jones?
I mean, the first thing we need to do is put people in Congress that actually have a record of doing things on this issue, which is not my opponent. I mean, he was on the Housing Committee in the Assembly and did absolutely nothing for this. There are different programs that I've seen in the VA as a veteran that help get people housing, especially if they do have challenges with respect to their economic situation. We also need to make it so that we're not doing things that are actually making it harder to get a house, like putting tariffs on Canadian wood. So I do agree that we need to do those things at the federal level to work with our states to make it so we can have things like multifamily housing in different areas, grants in other areas of our district so that people can actually live where they work as opposed to have to travel like they do right now.
Thank you.
For this round, we are looking for yes or no answers. Congress passed the first gun control legislation in three decades this past summer, but there's been disagreement about whether it went far enough. Would you raise the minimum age to purchase a semi-automatic rifle from 18 to 21 years old? Dr. Jones.
Yeah, I'm a gun owner myself. I served in the military. I took care of people that have been injured by guns. I also learned how to shoot an M16 while I was in the military. I do believe that people need proper training to use these weapons, so I think this is something that should be investigated.
Yes or no?
Again, like I said, I think it's something that needs to be investigated, and that's something I would look into.
Okay, Assemblymember Kiley.
I think you've asked two yes or no questions, and we haven't gotten an answer on either of them. But I would not support that, given the evidence that we've seen right now. There's no evidence that it would actually make our communities more safe. What I do support is greater assistance for mental health and for school safety and strengthening background checks. And I actually have sponsored legislation to detect early warning signs for possible active shooter situations in schools that has gotten broad support from law enforcement and from groups that advocate for safety in our schools.
Would you ban large capacity magazines that hold 15 or more bullets?
Again, I don't think that there's any evidence to show that that's going to actually move the needle in terms of safety. What I think we should do is pursue solutions that have been actually shown on the basis of evidence to work. And I also think we should, you know, by the way, that here in California, we have the strictest laws in this respect of any in the country. And there's a lot of ways in which the current laws aren't being enforced. We have a lot of felons out there who are illegally in possession of weapons, and our Department of Justice really isn't doing much about it. So I don't think the solution is to pile on regulation after regulation after regulation at the federal
level. Dr. Jones, would you vote to ban large capacity magazines?
I would, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Many voters are concerned about threats to our democracy. So again, yes or no, do you blame former President Trump for the January 6th Capitol riots? We'll start with you, Dr. Jones.
Being someone that was in the military and actually served with people that deployed overseas and protected our democracy, I do think that we need a president that is willing to stand up and not force these insurrections from occurring.
Do you blame the former president for the insurrection?
I do, yeah.
And
I blame the folks who committed these acts of violence. It was a horrifying event. It was one of the worst days in our country's history, and I blame those people as the ones responsible.
So our last two questions are a little more personal, and we need you to keep your answers to 30 seconds, please. A viewer, Mark Sobel, asks, what bothers you most about your own political party? Dr. Jones, you'll answer first.
I think the thing that bothers me the most is my political party focuses a lot of emphasis on D.C. It does have a problem with spending, and those are one of the reasons I want to go there and fix those types of things. We live in a district that does not have enough spending and resources with respect to federal lands. I think we need to put more of our resources and priorities here. That's what I think is one of the biggest problems with the Democratic Party, and that's one of the things I would try to fix.
Assemblymember Kiley, what bothers you most about the Republican Party?
Well, I think that, you know, some people believe that when the Republican Party has had control of Congress, a lot hasn't changed in terms of the way the government is run, in terms of the spending. And I think there have been times in the past when that's been true. And so, you know, again, though, I'm not running to represent one particular party. My opponent said that as the opening statement of his campaign. He wanted to help his party keep the majority. Here in the state assembly, I've authored some of the most groundbreaking legislation to pass in recent years on public safety, on freedom of speech, on protecting our kids in school. When you're in the minority, or super minority, as we are here in California, you have to work in a bipartisan way to do that, and that's what I'll do as a member of Congress.
That really goes right into our next question, which is that politics has become very polarized. People still want to feel, though, that their representative represents their own interests. So in this particular district, 33% of the voters are registered Democrats. If you became the congressperson representing CD3, mm-hmm. what would you do to help Democrats feel that specifically that you're representing their interests?
Well, you know, I've been very fortunate to get more votes than any member of my party in our state's entire history in any part of the state. And that's because I've gotten support from Democrats, Republicans, and independents.
But what would you do?
And people see that I don't necessarily agree with them on every single issue, but that I'm fighting for our area. And one example of this is fighting to get our schools open. We had our schools open earlier here than in any part of the state. California had the longest school shutdown in the country. My opponent went along with it. He never advocated for opening schools. And, you know, that harmed everyone. Democrat, Republican, and independent. And I have people to this day who tell me that they've never voted for another Republican except me because of what we were able to do for our kids.
Assemblymember, thank you. So same question for you, but 38% of the registered voters in the congressional, third congressional district are registered Republicans.
Right.
If you became their congressperson, what would you do to reassure them that you would have their back?
I mean, I would take care of them the same way that I take care of my patients. I've been a physician for about 17 years, more than half the time that my opponent's been alive. The things that I think people expect in their public leaders is that they're actually going to listen to them, focus on their issues, regardless of what they call themselves, regardless of who they love. They're going to focus on those issues that matter. So I will be a person that protects national access to abortion. I will be a person that protects those issues that people care about, whether it's their Social Security, which we know that some of the Republicans want to get rid of. So I will focus on those issues that they care about, regardless of whether they're Democrat or Republican. As long as it's right for our district, that's what I'm going to do.
Thank you. We want to make sure you have time for final statements.
Definitely.
Those are coming up right after a quick break. Stay with us.
Thanks.
Welcome back. It's time now for final statements from our candidates. Each of you will have 1 minute. Assemblymember Kiley, we'll start with you.
Well, thank you everyone very much for tuning in. Elections are about choices, and in this election, there's a very clear choice. My opponent started his campaign by saying his goal was to keep his party in power and advance the agenda of his national party. My goal is to be an independent voice for our district. My opponent has said he wants to take us even further down the road that we're on right now. I want to lead our country in a new direction. My opponent wants to make our government even more one-sided. I want to bring back some balance and common sense. And most of all, what I want to do is fight to protect our quality of life. This is the district where I was born and raised. My opponent's never lived here, and he wasn't even honest when he was asked in this debate about whether he lives here. He's run now for Congress in multiple congressional districts where he's never lived. But I feel incredibly blessed to have grown up in our communities where we have a quality of life and we've maintained a quality of life that doesn't exist in other parts of California. We don't have the level of crime that you have in LA, or waste that you have in San Francisco, or homelessness that you have in Sacramento. But that could change if we don't have the right political leadership. And so I want to fight as a member of Congress to maintain the quality of life in our area so it remains a great place to live, to work, to grow up, and to raise a family, and to retire.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Jones.
I think you saw tonight major differences between me and my opponent. I think the biggest thing is I'm not a career politician. I am a father of an 8-year-old and 3-year-old who I would give my life for. I'm a husband. I'm the son of a mom who I know it was her love who made me who I am. My opponent decided after college to become a politician. I decided to go to Iraq and serve our country because I do believe in those values that we hold dear. In the military, we were taught to put our mission first and our differences second. And I do believe that there are things that are bigger than politics, bigger than lies, and that is leadership. That's our children. That's our values. Those are the things I will fight for every single day. I don't want what happened to my family and our healthcare system to happen to you. I believe that this election is about our future. It really is about whether we are willing to have people that we send to Congress that are working for us, or whether we send people that think that we're working for them. I hope I earned your vote tonight, and I thank you so much for the opportunity to run.
Well, thank you both. We want to point out that many candidates refuse to debate. And we really appreciate you being willing to answer questions and to talk about your positions. We want to thank our viewers for some really great questions. I hope we were able to address a lot of those. And if you have any questions about the upcoming election, go to kcra.com for the voter guide.